I love coming up here. Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming tonight. I am your host for the evening, I guess. My name's Sarah Jaffe. I spoke here, about a year ago, huh? No, 6 months? I don't know. I don't know what day it is. It's March, right?
Spring.
Yeah, that's why it's 30 degrees out. Of course. Anyway, I was here because I wrote a book called Necessary Trouble, Americans in Revolt. But as always, it's a pleasure to stand under a picture of James Connolly and behind a picture of James Connolly and down the street from where James Connolly used to live, because, among other things, well, we're 101 years from the Easter Rising, but Connolly's work, and I talked about this a little bit in my talk last year as well, he's sort of a lesser known socialist in this country. We don't think of him as part of that tradition. We sort of talk about him in the Irish Republican tradition, and I think Ronan's talk tonight will probably do a good job of linking those two things together a little bit. But of course the James Connolly Forum here is named for him because he lived down the street here. Came to the United States in 1902, moved to Troy in 1903, lived at 96 Ingalls Avenue, where now you have a nice plaque commemorating that. He worked for the Metropolitan Insurance Company until a recession caused the firm to falter. While here, he was active in the Socialist Labor Party, where he, like most people who met Daniel De Leon, had a notable dispute with Daniel De Leon, this time over the utility of fighting for wage increases, which he was for, which is one of the reasons that he is one of my favorite historical socialists. As most of you probably are aware, after that, he returned to Ireland, played a leading role in things like the Dublin lockout, and then, of course, led the Irish Citizen Army, which I am repping with my little button here, in the Easter Rising, which happened 101 years ago on April 24th. So he was executed by the British in 1916, and today more people ought to recognize him as one of the great socialist leaders of the 20th century. And right now, before I introduce your guest, I am supposed to ask if anybody has announcements of upcoming events right up front.
So this year, there's a lot going on around May Day.
Well, because of James Connolly, 100 years later, because I was in Ireland last year for the 100th anniversary of the Easter Rising. Ronan Burtenshaw is the Europe editor for Jacobin Magazine and edited their Irish issue on that 100th anniversary, which is, there's a few left on the table over there. It sold out the first run, so get it quick. You may not see it again. He's a former researcher and political organizer. I can talk tonight. At the Dáil Éireann, or otherwise known as the Irish Parliament, because my Irish accent is atrocious. And a representative of the youth section of the Irish Congress of Trade Unions and is active in the Right to Water movement. He is based in Dublin, and we are very lucky to have him here in Troy. So.
Thanks for having me. I want to say, first of all, I commend the work done by John and the rest of the people behind this forum. The idea that Connolly is memorialized in this way, an active socialist politics in a community space, in a place where he lived and learned so much, is great to see. It's an honor really to speak at a forum named for Connolly. He was Ireland's greatest socialist, a man who never allowed theory fall far from action, who matched his intellectual commitment to revolution with gallantry, sacrifice, and ultimately martyrdom in battle, and who maintained throughout his life the ambition to win the earth for all of its people. He synthesized the national, democratic, social, and economic questions of his time into a republican socialist ideology, marking him out as one of the outstanding Marxists theorists of the Second International period, someone who should rightly claim a place beside Luxembourg and Lenin in the canon. And his time in America shaped him profoundly. Here, as a militant in the burgeoning trade union movement and a member of the Socialist Party, he would deepen his internationalism but also learn about the methods of the sympathetic strike, something that he took back to Ireland when James Connolly and Jim Larkin in 1913 led the greatest industrial dispute in the history of our Ireland. in the Dublin lockout. Something that was built on trade union methods and tactics that he learned during his period in the United States. But it's his organising with migrant workers and his passion telling their story, I think, is perhaps the most relevant to us today, especially with all of you facing the racist retrenchment of the Trump administration and campaigns that you have to fight against that. Speaking of the Statue of Liberty, Connolly would write, "It is placed on a pedestal out of reach of the multitudes. It can only be approached by those who have money to pay the expense. It has a lamp to enlighten the world, but the lamp is rarely lit, and it smiles upon us as we approach America, but once we are in the country, we never see anything but its back." But America, particularly its working class, has also given much to the world, and maybe nowhere more than Ireland. It is especially gratifying, I think, for me to be here on the 150th anniversary of the Fenian Uprising in 1867, something I wrote about on St. Patrick's Day for Jacobin. It was a radical insurrection led by mainly Irish Americans. Not only people who, like James Stephen, spent much of their time in the United States and was recruited into Marx's First International by an Italian radical here in New York, but also by Union veterans like Colonel Thomas Kelly, who was a leader of the 10th Ohio in America's Great War against slavery. Fenians from America fought the British in Ireland and in Canada in raids later in the year in 1867, only months after fighting the Confederacy in the South, and issued a proclamation that echoed through our history. "Republicans of the entire world," they wrote, "our cause is your cause, our enemy is your enemy. Let your hearts be with us." And 150 years later, the Irish Republic they hoped to see, one that they wrote about where the soil of Ireland would be liberated from an oligarchy, where people would live without the profiteering of aristocratic locusts, where every person would secure the intrinsic value of their labour and enjoy absolute liberty of conscience with complete separation of church and state, remains some way off, but a goal socialist Republicans like myself aim to see achieved. That revolution that Sarah spoke about in the early part of her discussion there of 100 years ago remains unfinished. The period of tumult between 1916 and 21 was a deep-seated social contestation. Not alone did thousands of people take up arms against British imperialism in Ireland, removing from the state a sheen of legitimacy. But the idea of national revolution and liberation, a clean slate from which to build a new society, encouraged other struggles against exploitation and oppression. During the War of Independence, more than 100 Soviets were declared across Ireland from mental institutions, where the first one was declared in Monaghan, the Monaghan Soviet led by Padraig O'Donnell, to mines in the border areas and bakeries in the west, and even an entire city in Limerick, which became a Soviet for a number of weeks, run by its workers in 1919. And women too made the struggle for emancipation their own, leading a women's workers union, forming an auxiliary unit of the volunteers to fight as coming on in the 16 Rising, and grounding the right to universal suffrage in the Republican cause. It was this battle, this latter battle for women's rights, which ensured Constance Markievicz would become the first woman minister in Europe when she was appointed the Minister for Labour of the Revolutionary Government in 1919. But the threat of absolute war by the largest empire on the face of the earth, and the theft of a revolution by counter-revolutionaries in a thermidor led by our Catholic middle classes, buried the aspirations of this era beneath two broken states, a southern dungeon governed by a conspiracy of priests and gombeens, and a northern barracks under the sectarian orange rule, which denied most of its citizens basic rights. As we pass through this decade of centenaries, where we remember that era 100 years ago, I think it is fair to say, for those of us who are active now, that those two states have never been in a weaker position since their formation. And the 26 counties moving to the end of the 20th century, after a period of unprecedented growth, which was really a catching up on the forced underdevelopment which had gone on for decades in Ireland, came to a crashing end with the financial crisis. It's very important for us to understand the economic model. If you're thinking about socialism, I think far too rarely do we talk in serious terms about political economy and the way in which this underwrites how we're going to have to struggle for liberation at a future point. Our model was based on a form of capitalism with a comprador ruling class, which is to say a ruling class which acted as a middleman. And this came out of the failed revolution. In the context of the failure of Ireland's revolution, what ended up happening was a southern ruling class acting as handmaidens, largely for continued domination by British capitalists of Ireland, which went on for decades through the 20th century. Not only, of course, British, it extended internationally too, just as James Connolly had warned when he said, if in establishing a republic and flying a green flag over Dublin Castle, if you did not establish a socialist republic, all your efforts will have been in vain. And where these middlemen had stood between, for most of the 20th century, between Ireland's cattle and their processing in Britain, effectively exporting, like so many colonial states, the raw materials for processing and production in the core capitalist countries. As the 20th century developed, they found a new and interesting resource, one that tells us actually a lot about the development of capitalism across the world in the 20th century. And this resource was Ireland's right to set its own tax policies and regulation. Having decided in the middle of the century to abandon any pretense of indigenous industrial policy, preferring instead to industrialise by invitation to multinational corporations, Ireland's elite in the 1980s reduced our corporation tax rate to 10% and set about attracting financial giants to the country with specially designated financial services centres and clearing houses in which major banks could use. Literally, I think people sometimes are surprised by this. It was a literal case. Could use to write their own laws. With the resurgent capitalism of the early 1990s, powered by globalization and the demolition of trade barriers and barriers to the movement of capital, this model was one that worked to a degree. It fit into the parts of the capitalist system that had most vitality, and the state, the southern state, benefited for a time from these policies, but in a deeply uneven and unequal way. And with a model that placed Ireland at the forefront when the financial crisis hit in 2008. That crisis tore through Irish society. One tenth of the population of the south was forced to emigrate. The private sector saw widespread layoffs, and the public sector saw cuts in wages of up to 35%. Essential services such as health were plunged into crises of underfunding. Unemployment shot through double digits. Ireland rose to have, by now, the second highest number of low-paid jobs in the OECD or the developed world. And there were political consequences for this. Fianna Fáil, the second most successful party in European democracy after Sweden's Social Democrats, having governed the southern state for most of its history, were punished in 2011 in that general election, their vote halved. But they were replaced by another centrist coalition, the Christian Democrats of Fine Gael and their off-time liberal bedfellows in the Irish Labour Party. For a time, this coalition enjoyed a honeymoon period. Waves of emigration. I was involved in a campaign during this time called We're Not Leaving, which sought to emphasise the way in which emigration in Ireland has been used through decades as a social release valve, as a way of limiting the pressures that would come on if we had hundreds of thousands of predominantly young people in our dole queues. Instead, our government introduces policies and incentivize people to leave. There is an effect of forced migration for economic circumstances. And this release valve released some of the social anger. So too, digs the decades of growth before the crash. And the idea for a lot of people, my grandparents' generation for sure, but also I think my parents' generation to a degree, that Ireland had done well before the crash and would simply return to some kind of Celtic Tiger economy. This gave rise to a term. Ireland had a new title in Europe for so many years, having been the sick man of Europe, with its most underdeveloped economy in the west of Europe and its high rates of emigration and poverty. It then became the poster child, the willing pupil to Angela Merkel's disciplinarian austerity program, the good pig, so to speak, Portugal, Ireland, Italy, Greece, Spain, to be contrasted with those other countries and their resistances. But this didn't last, thankfully. There were those of us who despaired for a number of years under those circumstances. But beginning in 2014, the poster child misbehaved. Ireland's attempt, the government's attempt to introduce water charges, were a spark that ignited an enormous movement. It was a perfect storm, a new consumption tax which disproportionately hit the working class, a likely course to privatisation with the involvement of a leading Irish oligarch, and perceived government corruption, produced the Right to Water movement, which was the largest social movement in the history of the southern state. A coalition which was formed initially by the left wing of our trade union movement, the wing which probably won't surprise you I'm involved in. In addition to our bigger left wing parties, those from Sinn Féin across to the Trotskyist left, and probably the most important aspect of it, which is one that provides us with the greatest opportunities and the greatest difficulties when we think about socialist politics in Ireland today. It's a self-organised, largely autonomous working class groups of resistance which sprung up against the water meters, but which operated outside of the traditional institutions of left-wing politics. So not members of the Sinn Féin, Trotskyist parties. These were, many of them were members of trade unions, but were not active with them and were sceptical, for very good reasons, of trade union leaderships. And this coalition, difficult as it was at times to manage, between people who are quite new to politics and radicalising, people who are decades old in politics, who had been part of our trade union and left movement since the last great iterations of struggle in Ireland, was the most dynamic thing we've seen in politics in a very, very long time. The largest demonstration that we saw, and we saw a number of demonstrations of six figures, the largest we saw was around 200,000 people in a southern state of just over 4 million. So those are really exceptional numbers in terms of the size. And it was an exceptional movement led by the working class, with the involvement of the best layers of organised labour and a strong internationalist perspective during the period when the Syriza government in Greece in 2015 was resisting EU austerity. Demonstrations were regularly filled with Greek flags, and speakers who addressed them were received extremely positively by people who were new to politics, new to resistance, but had a sense of people standing up and fighting back against similar conditions to their own. And that movement shook the southern establishment. Although they held on to power in the 2016 general election, their numbers were seriously reduced. The government of the day, Fine Gael and Labour, lost a third of its seats, and parties and candidates to the left of the Labour Party, which was historically, for most of Irish history, the break on left-wing politics, candidates and parties to the left of that secured between 25 and 30% of the vote, something that was historic high, unprecedented, and honestly something we couldn't have predicted even a few years ago. And for decades since the foundation of the state, as an evidence of this, Fianna Fáil or Fine Gael never received less than 75%. This went all the way until the 90s, actually. And even up until the 2000s, they were still receiving 70% of the vote. Their vote in 2016 fell to below 50%. So it was a seismic shift, and they were forced for the first time to govern together in a pact arrangement, which they're in at the moment, uncomfortably. For the first time, we managed to put the two centre-right parties who rotated at the head of the Southern State, where their policies belong, which is in the same government and the same formation, rather than in some kind of false competition, which I think many of you will recognise here. But this opening was not fully taken advantage of. The Irish people turned away from the establishment rather than decisively towards the left. Sinn Féin, in a power-sharing arrangement in the north, where they were growing in power but changing in social base, were unable to capitalise to the degree the party expected. Sinn Féin is the most significant force on the Irish left. The party's position, it has grown enormously from the early 2000s until today. It is now a party that can command somewhere in the region of 700,000 votes in the north of Ireland on a cross-class basis from the national community, but which in the south gets, in the last election, about 14% of the vote. And this is squarely a working class vote. This is the vote that is taken from the areas that have been most affected by austerity, with most of its activists and militants being drawn from those communities. At the same time, the party's focus on unification of the country has provided some problems for it in an era when particularly in the southern state, the energy has been towards the opposition to austerity. And so, on the one hand, a media establishment, which has always hated Sinn Féin, did everything it could to discredit the party and change the discussion from its platform, constantly referring to the history of the Irish Republican Army and party scandals dating from the era of the Troubles, to distract from Sinn Féin's widely popular positions on increasing taxation on the wealthy and improving our health service. This is something to which the party, I think, would say themselves, were not able to respond during that election campaign, and were finding it very difficult to maintain a position which, at one and the same time, was trying to convince people that it was different from its past as the political wing of the IRA, at the same time maintaining a tradition within republicanism which justified the similar path that it was on today. But there are, I think, as well as just the unfair and anti-republican critiques of the mainstream press, there are also big limitations to Sinn Féin, which those of us who are socialists have to grapple with. The party's unwillingness to challenge Ireland's debt burden in a serious way, to break with the European Union, which crushed Greece's rebellion, to increase corporation tax or seriously explore alternatives to the model of the economy I just outlined, based on foreign direct investment, are serious obstacles to even moderate social democratic politics. The other major force to emerge during this period was the Trotskyist left in Ireland. This is the Socialist Workers' Party, otherwise known as People Before Profit, and the Socialist Party, otherwise known as Anti-Austerity Alliance, actually, which has just changed its name again to Solidarity. Both now have 3 members of Parliament, by contrast to Sinn Féin's 27, and played leading roles in the Right to Order movement. Their activists were hugely important in working class communities, fighting at the forefront against installations. A number of them actually are facing court cases coming up soon, with the Irish state attempted to repress them in doing so. And in certain ways, they pushed Sinn Féin to the left, but they also remain wedded, in my opinion, to a model of organising that makes building parties, larger parties, capable of representing the huge working class resistance we saw since 2014, very difficult. Not only are these two parties unwilling to come together themselves within what is a very close political position in Trotskyism, but they were in a formation before called the United Left Alliance, which I was a member of unfortunately, which did not last, and descended into a infighting in a way that badly damaged our movement and our ability to convince working class people that we were able to provide socialists alternatives to the situation they were facing rather than endless sectarian infighting. Both groups are also disinclined to serve in left government with Sinn Féin. This is a problem for those of us in the socialist left and the trade union movement, who see our greatest opportunity as being a left government in Ireland that was willing to fight back against austerity. It's also a problem on a more general basis, because it gives Sinn Féin a carte blanche to flirt with the right. Sinn Féin, a party that is aiming to unify the country, that has a historic mission in its sights, is not inclined to wait around for smaller parties on more radical platforms to dictate to it how and when a left government might be formed at some future date. And instead, its flirtations with the right are likely to increase. The fallout from the Brexit referendum, which looks set to reintroduce a hard border onto the island after years of progress under the peace process, has propelled Sinn Féin in six counties to a historic high in terms of its vote share and changed the unification debate in a very fundamental way. So, for most of the history of the unification debate, it was one led by the left with an argument that we must break the states north and south and build a new republic, a workers' republic, on the vision of James Connolly. Today, with the prospect of a hard border being introduced again in Ireland, the business class in the south, particularly in border areas, are much, much more favourable than they've ever been in any stage in history to unification, seeing it as a way of preventing trade barriers from arriving on the islands. The unionist middle class in the north as well is softening, and the most recent assembly election showed their disinclination to vote for traditional unionist parties like the DUP, who supported Brexit. That election produced a strong result for Sinn Féin, as I said, but also the first assembly in history without a unionist majority. This is something 15, 20 years ago people would have said was impossible, really. Liberal parties such as the Alliance, which declare themselves to be neither nationalists nor unionists, and the Irish wing of the Green Party, hold the balance of power. And it's likely to be a situation that will become even more complex and probably more favourable towards unification if Scottish independence happens. The end result of this for the left is far from clear. Certainly on the question of unification, it's not the kind of unification we once imagined we would have. There's an opportunity for a unification campaign now fought from the middle, arguing that uniting Ireland would be less change than introducing a hard border, with business voices prominent and middle of the workers' republic vision that has animated our cause for decades. The path to socialism in Ireland will be complex, and the hardest task of all will be breaking an economic model based on foreign direct investment and low taxation, one that, when you imagine the prospect of nationalising, let alone socialising, companies like Dell or Apple, who produce one part in a complex globalised production chain in Ireland, will be really difficult, if not impossible. It will require a far more internationalist focus than the Irish left has had for most of its history. But these are difficulties that are the flip side of opportunities. If the Irish left cannot take advantage of a historically weak political right in Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael, a declining unionist bloc in the six counties, an ongoing crisis of capitalism, which is affecting all of the countries in the advanced capitalist world, then Ireland produces endless cycles of social crises for the working class, we're unlikely to be able to take power in better circumstances. The Right to Water campaigns, coalition of left-wing parties, trade unions and social movements in my view, points the way forward. One that must be built from the base of the working class communities that were the forefront of the struggle in right to order, that must be strengthened with political orientations that emphasize socialist politics and give an expression in new organized forms, ones that we have as yet failed to produce. But to quote James Connolly in 1916, socialists must be rebels at heart and rebel against even the limitations that are set to them. Opportunities are for those who seize them, and the coming year may be as bright as we choose to make it. Thank you.
Yeah. Two large questions. The first is, I know relatively little about the water struggle. Okay, so maybe you could talk in a little bit more detail about that. And then the second thing is, I heard Varoufakis talk about some sort of European movement about austerity, and I'd be curious what you have to say about that.
So I'll start with the water struggle. The water struggle began in early 2014.
That's all right, just leave it.
So in early 2014, there was a policy announced to introduce water charges. Now, lots of parts of the world have water charges, and many of my comrades elsewhere in Europe were wondering why this had become such an animating issue. But there were a lot of layers to this. This was another form of indirect taxation in the first instance. After years of introducing indirect taxation, that was going to hit working class people. It was a stepping stone to privatization, with a major Irish oligarch introducing the water meters, somebody who it was widely understood would not be doing so if this wasn't the first step on the way to commodification. And it also had resistance, I think, because there was a feeling that it was done without consent. And so previously in the 1990s, there had been an attempt to introduce water charges. It had been defeated, and the government, the parties that entered government in 2011 didn't have this in their program. And so this was, the idea was, this was something that was done without consent. It began in working class communities in Dublin and Cork, people themselves organizing. Well, I have to be honest here, most of our political factions were debating what kind of formation we could possibly put in place to deal with this issue and engaged in ludicrous sectarian argumentation. Working class communities were organizing in Cork and in Dublin to prevent the installation of water meters, confronting the police, in many cases being arrested. This was radicalizing other people and forces in their areas. It pushed the trade unions to take more serious lines. It actually pushed a number of our left trade unions to be more clear in their differentiation with the social democratic unions. So it marked the end of my time in the Congress of Trade Unions, which is the overarching, because there was no longer effectively a single line on this in Congress, and it was impossible for those of us on the left to remain within an organization that was backing the charges. And so that pushed us to a point where we needed some kind of a central organization to give expression to that struggle. And to lead it forward. What happened was the left trade unions, in an attempt to bolster peace between the warring left factions in the political sphere, formed a basis. They said, we will call together a right to order campaign, we'll fund the demonstrations, we'll host the meetings. It did come together, and from the beginning, I went to the first one and I was expecting 30,000 people, 40,000 people. I knew it was a big movement. I'd been out at some of the resistances, but I didn't know how big. And the first one went over 100,000, well over 100,000, which is enormous for a demonstration in Dublin. And then it just kept going. Every demonstration we had for the next 6 months, we got six figures. And there was an enormous one of over 200,000 people, which was in the start of 2015. No, actually the end of 2014. But it kept going. Every 3 months, we'd have another demonstration. And we've done well. We prevented the water charges from being introduced. They're off the table. It's gone. We have prevented any further introduction of meters. There's still a debate in the Parliament to be had over this, but effectively we forced the right-wing parties to concede on that. And when I was working in Parliament, I was working with the Right to Water Coalition, and one of our aims was to get through a piece of legislation which would allow for a referendum on public ownership, which would prevent water ever being privatised in the future. I think we're going to get that through, which means we will have had real victories on this issue, or comprehensive defeat of the establishment on this issue. But as we know, you defeat them in one place, they pop up in another.
Yeah.
The solution has to be to remove them. The difficulty is how to do it. On the question of DiEM25, the Democracy in Europe movement, Varoufakis was a tremendous communicator during the period of the Syriza government in Greece. Actually, he was on Irish radio. One of the things that made possible the solidarity we had was Varoufakis was calling into Irish radio shows and insisting to be allowed to speak on Greece when it was happening, and was doing a fantastic job of it. I have a lot of respect for the work that Varoufakis does, and I think particularly as a communicator of alternative economic ideas, just hardly any of people who can do it as well as him. And we need more communicators on the left, and I encourage that. I disagree with him on the European Union, and I disagree with him because his DiEM25, the aim is to try and create a movement in different parts of the European Union which will reform it from the inside. The problem, so far as I see, is that in every instance where there is a possibility for a left-wing government in Europe, the institutions as they exist are shaped in such a way as to prevent that government from making a step forward. And so what we get instead of this internationalist approach, which is what some proponents would frame it as, what we get is a situation where Syriza in Greece, rather than being able to provide even social democratic measures to encourage us to have left governments in Ireland or with Podemos in Spain or in Portugal, what actually happens is that they get crushed, and it sends the popular feeling the other way. People get afraid of challenging the European Union. And actually, our votes, in my view, in the 2016 election, good as they were lower than they would have been if we'd had it a few months earlier when Syriza was still fighting. And there are some reasons for that. I'm going to a very deep critique of the European Union, but very important reasons. It is structurally very undemocratic. Not only because you have a situation where the vast majority of the legislation that goes through doesn't come through the parliamentary body in the first instance, not only because there is a permanent bureaucracy which operates to facilitate neoliberal agenda inside the EU, but its actual constitutional basis. The Maastricht Treaty, a treaty which says there must be absolute freedom of movement for capital, cannot be a basis for socialist governments. The fiscal treaty that was passed in 2012, which says you cannot have higher than 3% deficit in any circumstances, nor can you go over 100% of GDP, I think it is, of debt, debt to GDP ratio. These things outlaw Keynesianism, let alone more radical policies than that. It's not something you can operate within. Nor is the euro. The euro is the most monetarist currency ever designed. Central bank, the European Central Bank's prerogative is, unlike even the Fed, you guys at least have people who sit in your Fed have to look out for unemployment as well. Our central bankers are limited to only looking out for inflation. And so they're in a constant kind of monetarist war against any policies which could lead to inflation. What would happen effectively in Europe, and what is happening, what we're seeing, is the only way that this structure as it is can be changed would be a radical left-wing government in Germany. This is like the age-old question of the European left, right? Everyone has to wait until the German working class gets off its fucking ass. I'm not inclined to do that. I think if those of us in Ireland and Spain and Portugal have to abort our struggles until such a time as the German working class elects a left government, we're unlikely to succeed. And so I think we have to look for ways outside the European Union. Not that it's a simple answer. It will mean finding a new place for yourself within a global production chain, within global flows of capital. It'll mean aligning with other left-wing governments. But I think it would probably mean we have to see left governments in the European periphery, like Ireland, Spain, Portugal, aligning with each other outside and creating a new federation rather than trying to do everything through that structure.
Speaking of internationalizing the struggle, it's interesting. We've had a speaker here from Bolivia, Marcelo Oliveira, who was a brother, Oscar, led the water fight in Bolivia. Have there been any communication between Irish activists and folks in Bolivia?
Bolivians? Yes, there has been. Ireland has, in addition to here, there's actually a fascinating tradition in Latin America of Irish emigrants and involvement in revolutionary situations. And so there's a long-standing connection between our Republican movement and aspects of the Latin American left. We had speakers from Bolivia, from MAS, Evo Morales' party, but also from Cochabamba, where the water struggle happened, in Ireland, giving accounts of their battle. And in one way it was an inspiring one, because they managed to achieve a very radical social transformation through water, insofar as the MAS government was elected with Morales, and it changed things in a social democratic fashion. But in another sense, I think it left us kind of wondering when they were coming, as I'm sure you all know, the Latin American left, having had so many years of success, was facing the opposite, retrenchment. Morales had lost that referendum. And I think actually my view is, for those of us in the European left, particularly in its periphery, particularly those of us in former colonies, the Latin American left is the experience we have to look towards most closely. Because it is one where there were reforming governments who managed to produce a space for themselves under neoliberalism to do left-wing things when none of the rest of us did. It shows its limitations too, insofar as the resurgence of the right now, but it gives us a sense of what a reforming left-wing government could do.
I just spent a month at our colony, Puerto Rico, not mine, our government, and I really got a sense of the colonialism and how it's wreaked havoc in Puerto Rico, and there were a lot of similarities with your struggle in Ireland, being an island country, and the U.S. being the safety valve for immigration as we continue to put dire economic systems on them. And I read a little bit about Albuso Campos and how he had a relationship with the nationalist leader who led the uprising in 1950. And he had connections with the Irish struggle. Are you aware of that? You know, any particulars about the connection with Puerto Rico and
the
Irish?
Yeah, the Puerto Rican Liberation Movement. If I'm not wrong, one of their leaders was recently hired, right?
Oscar Lopez.
Yes, Oscar Lopez. Oscar Lopez was connected to and supportive of the struggle of the hunger strikers, I think. He was very widely regarded, at least in Sinn Féin. There was a lot of satisfaction on his release. Puerto Rico does have some histories of connection with Ireland, like other Latin American countries. I think actually now, the situation, as you've just said, is perhaps the one that draws best comparison. It's debt crisis. And what the thing that I often think of when I'm looking at situations like that, countries as divergent as Ireland and Puerto Rico, ending up because of their relation to the imperial core with such similar circumstances. So every time someone tells me, capitalism, is it really a thing? I mean, the world is so diverse, it's so complex. Can you really talk about one system existing and all, you know, these kind of critiques that we've got more recently from various parts of liberalism and some parts of the left? You just need to look at examples like that, where societies with such enormous differences in history and so forth end up with such similar circumstances, so far apart, with debt crises, with emigration, with cultural struggles that they're trying to wage, you know, and independence campaigns, with long-standing political prisoners with similar political economic makeups and the kind of handmaiden capitalists who run some of these states, like in Puerto Rico, who allow for the exploitation of that country against the interests of its people. I always look at those situations and think to myself, how could anyone not see that this whole thing is interlinked, and similar situations prevail in many different cases in different places.
What's your take on Sinn Féin wanting quote unquote a special status for the North?
It's a difficult question because I understand totally what they're after. I don't want to see a hard border imposed in the north of Ireland. I think it would be a disaster, a rowing back of the progress of the peace process years. Like one of the whole basis on which that peace process was built, there were big problems with it because at one level, two different traditions were told two different stories. Okay, so the Unionist tradition was told a story about the defeat of the Republican movement, finally putting down its arms and so forth, coming to terms with democratic politics. The Republican movement was told this is a stepping stone to unification. I'm one of those people who happens to believe that those lies, and so far as they're told to various degrees, come back and bite you eventually, and we may see that happening. But right now, what Sinn Féin are arguing for is that we don't want a hard border. And that's correct. I want to see a unified Ireland. I want to see a new society built in the entirety of the island. I don't want to see two broken states stitched together, would be Bernadette Devlin was talking about this recently. Said the only thing that could make our island worse was the idea of both of these sets of gobshites running the country together. But I think the problem that comes out of this politically is that Sinn Féin, having been a Eurocritical party for almost all of its history, opposing the entry to the European Union, opposing every treaty of integration of the European Union, not because, by the way, we're anti-European in any sense, but because of the structure, concretely, of what it is in terms of its political economy, is now reliably found to be one of the most pro-European Union parties in its discourse, at least. Not that it doesn't make criticisms, but almost every time the EU is discussed, they frame the whole thing as a conversation about not wanting to be sucked into the Brexit right in Britain and what they've done and so forth. Whereas actually the problem will be, if we don't start a conversation with Irish people, and working class people particularly, about the limitations of the European Union, we're not going to be able to do any of the things we want to do if we get a government in this place. So having a conversation about a special status, just taking the north of Ireland back into the EU, which is effectively what's being proposed here, maybe it's a short-term solution. But in the longer term, unless that is somehow mixed with a critical argument about the structures of the European Union, we're going to be walking people up a garden path in the very same fashion that Syriza did. And the result in Greece has been devastating. Really the death of its left, in my view, for years to come. It's an outcome worth avoiding. And that would be my problem with it.
You know, given what's happening in this country in terms of the isolationist and anti-immigrant rhetoric policies and challenges that we're facing in this country, I'm sort of curious as to what's happening in Ireland. Do you have a Muslim issue that is being challenged? And
sure.
Also, do you have any issues with anti-immigration, because you have other large nationalities like Africans maybe that might exist. So can you just
speak to that? I think one of the first things when we talk about the quote from Connolly that always comes to my mind when I listen to Trump and his so-called Americanism is Connolly had a great quote where he said, "Ireland without our people is nothing to me. A man who can walk through the streets and see the degradation and shame wrought by Irish men upon Irish men and women and not burn in their heart to end it is, in my view, a fraud and a liar in his heart, no matter how much he claims to love that chemical composition that he calls Ireland." That to me is Trump, right? Trump is somebody who represents this kind of America, which is an America that is evacuated of its people. It's an America which is an idea of the flag, but which has very little to do with the kind of battles you were talking about of improving people's healthcare in this country. Actually, I was really taken in New York when I was there in the last few days at the contradictions of it, and seeing this incredible city built that shows us what we could do with all of our assembled resources and the really in-your-face poverty that is on every street corner. 60,000 homeless people who are living in dreadful conditions. On the question of racism, Ireland, I have a very interesting story on this one. We had, for St. Patrick's Day, a former minister of Ireland, Éan O'Riordan, who was in our Labour Party, was over here doing something called the Irish Stand, which was an event that was supposed to be supporting immigrants, as was how it was put. Éan O'Riordan, during his time as a minister in the last government, up to 2016, oversaw a programme called Direct Provision, which is where asylum seekers in Ireland are forced to live. These are unbelievably bad and cramped, overcrowded facilities in which 5,000 asylum seekers live in a state of constant limbo for years without knowing what their status is, in which there is no right to work, there is no right to make your own meals. Half of the people living in them are children. It's an unconscionable situation. Éan O'Riordan introduced laws to speed up the deportation of these people, and he was here being feted by liberals in the United States as a champion of immigration because he made a speech calling Donald Trump a fascist. Well, okay, but you know, listen, anyone can say Donald Trump's a fascist, and plenty of people who occupy the political mainstream create the conditions that allow for Donald Trump. They normalize mass deportations and racist policies, which then get extended by Donald Trump, not introduced, don't come from the ether. Barack Obama deported more people from this country than any other president in history. And then they turn around on the other side and they're scandalized by Donald Trump, rightly so. But you know, let's see where these things come from. Ireland has a mixed tradition then. On one side, those of us in the socialist left have to acknowledge absolutely where the racist parts of our state exist. The fact that people like that are in government, the fact that they introduce policies to make migration and so on harder. At the same time, it would be naive of us not to notice and respect and try and cultivate the fact that Ireland has a very strong anti-racist tradition. We are one of the only countries in Europe with no radical right party of any size. We have no Le Pen, we have no Farage, we have no Trump. Now, we have people within the main parties who are presenting nicer faces and doing desperate things, but at the same time, the fact that we don't have that comes down to, I think, partly our history of migration and an understanding of that experience. It comes down to the hard work of the left fighting over many years. The Republican movement in particular, it helps, you know, when you're fighting against fascists and arriving on the scene and so forth, when you've got an armed left-wing group which is, you know, not allowing these people to have street energy, that is very useful. And that was what happened effectively. For many, many years, the Republican tradition in Ireland did not allow fascists to organise. If they attempted to do it, they were broken up and stopped. And we also have, you know, for many years we did have a smaller proportion of our population that were migrants. No question about that, we were mainly an emigrant nation, many decades of migration outwards. That is no longer the case. We now have a higher proportion of people in Ireland born outside the country than Britain or France, which is very striking. Large communities from Poland, other parts of Eastern Europe, large communities from West Africa. And it remains to be seen. I mean, I think that we're storing ourselves up some trouble in terms of the way in which the union movement is not organizing effectively in migrant communities, in which the government is allowing the development of facilitating the development of kind of segregated areas in some of our cities, in which migrants are living almost exclusively I think that there are problems in that area that are being stored up. But actually, in racism, in European terms, Ireland is not in the worst position at the moment, and it's something that the socialist left is aware that it has to fight constantly on.
When the Scottish referendum happened, I remember it being described as like a once in a lifetime type of vote, and then we're just talking about reunification being a possibility. So the question I have is, there are actually four countries in the British Isles, and I recall recently an article in like the Guardian that talked about a potential of a Welsh referendum. And sort of describing it as like Wales is only ever given any consideration, particularly by the Labour Party, when it comes down to an election, and then afterwards it's forgotten. And so, you know, with all this potential for a second referendum that was sort of unanticipated and reunification, what's going on the ground in Wales?
Wales is a country that at the moment does not have an enormous push towards independence. It has Plaid Cymru, which is a Welsh Nationalist Party, which is similar to the SNP in many cases, but on a much smaller level of vote. Look, the question of nationalism is, for me, an interesting one in these regards. I think people should have a right to vote on secession if there is demand for it. I think the states that deny that expose their imperial qualities. On the other hand, there are differences between the experiences of different parts of the British Isles. When I speak to my comrades in Scotland, many of whom are in the independence movement, I think it is important for us, those of us who are Marxists, to distinguish between national liberation as a struggle against active oppression and struggles for independence, which are not of oppressed peoples. And this is important because I think we are entering an era where there's going to be a disaggregation, where there's going to be parts of countries going to be looking for independence, not necessarily for progressive reasons, some of which we saw, by the way, in Latin America. We're talking about Bolivia, for instance. There was the most wealthy and right-wing areas in Santa Cruz was looking for independence in a struggle. I don't say that about Scotland or Wales, but I do say that we have to think about those conflicts and those political battles differently. It has to be a question of, is this going to advance the left? Not a kind of absolute principle that people who are under active oppression are entitled to national liberation. It has to be a tactical, conjunctional question. Will this set us forward? In Wales, at the moment, the Plaid Cymru is the second party after the Labour Party. The Labour Party has had 18 months of great opportunity to be building things under Jeremy Corbyn, and it hasn't gone the way we would hope. I have to be honest about that. But at the same time, it has a very deep socialist tradition, which is very red. It is the Wales was the heart of so much of the miners' struggle. It still produces some of the best left Labour MPs. It's not really like Scotland had become, where they were all Blairites and so on. There are certainly some of those, but some of the most important backers of the Corbyn movement are Welsh people from mining communities. If it does happen that the Brexit process that the Tories are dragging the country through produces Welsh independence movements, I think it's quite possible. We'll have to look at it and see, are they going to be trying to stand on left platforms, and if so, what is their proposal to be an independent country that is able to win socialist policies, which is by no means easy for independent states, but which we have to assess if it comes up.
On the question of fascism in Ireland, I think we should not forget that the origins of Fine Gael,
yes,
in the brown shirts and whatnot. But that wasn't my question. That was just a comment I wanted to throw in. I was interested to hear you refer to Sinn Féin as part of the socialist left, because I know back in the 70s, when they were still split, when the officials had given up the armed struggle and were moving slowly left went into the ITP and assorted other left-wing movements. And the provisionals were maintaining the armed struggle and the need for unification. They were not considered to be anything close to left-wing, except in a very kind of pragmatic way, because some of the policies that they were exposing for United Ireland, you know, the era newer and whatnot. So I'm interested to hear you explain that transition from a sort of neo-right-wing nationalist armed struggle movement to part of the.
Right. I think if I'd been in the Republican movement at that stage, I would have sided with the officials. Going back to explain a little bit about what happened at that time, there was the border campaign in Ireland in the 50s, which was a really narrow and unsuccessful campaign that was exclusively kind of militaristically focused with very little political struggle around it, and which failed. And numerous of the leaders of the movement at that time of the IRA were imprisoned in Britain, ever a British prison to produce a revolutionary. Carl Goulding, the leader of the IRA, was imprisoned with a lot of communists and came out as a communist, and began to try to take the IRA, which was at that stage a nationalist and quite narrow force, you know, which appealing to Gaelic mysticism and various other things, attempted to take them in a left-wing direction. My critique of Goulding would be that he overdetermined the situation. He tried to do things in a way that was simply unsustainable. It's not possible to take a movement that had that kind of a base in a 2 or 3 year period into one that was going to be a Marxist and a communist a movement. And so inevitably enough, when you overdetermine the situation, there was a split. The officials went on to become a communist organization with the Workers' Party in the South. And the provisionals, as you say, maintained, they were, you know, a lot of the stuff they were saying at that time of that split was really red baiting, was anti-communist, was, you know, these people are godless and all the rest of it. But that happened at a time before, I mean, there was a tumultuous events that followed this. It was the culmination of the civil rights struggle, which brought masses of people into politics fighting for civil rights in the North. There was the growth of the Republican movement after that was repressed with Bloody Sunday and the massacre of people in the streets of Derry. And then there was the hunger strikes campaign in the early 80s. I mean, by that stage, the leader of the hunger strikes, Bobby Sands, was describing himself as a socialist, was somebody who was, you know, well-read in anti-colonial socialist politics, had an understanding of what that meant in terms of, well, at least in terms of taking over the commanding heights of the economy and so on. And basically what my analysis of what happened there is that it reflected the base, that the official movement, official IRA, decided to try to do a unite and fight approach between the Catholic and Unionist working classes at a time when there was still active oppression of the Catholic working class. There were still Catholics getting shot dead for protesting for civil rights. And the result of that, when the IRA, led by the officials, declined to defend working class communities of Belfast, the working class sided with the provisionals, working class in the Catholic areas. And the provisionals became, through the 70s into the 80s, the expression of working class Catholic communities in the North. This is my analysis also of Martin McGuinness, sadly passed away this week. I think he was a very good example of this in the contradictions of him and Adams, who I think are different souls within the party of Sinn Féin, but show really why the party ended up with a progressive working class leaning base. McGuinness was a working class fella from the Bogside who, as Gerry Adams said, he didn't go to war. It wasn't as if he strapped on a backpack and picked up a gun and went to some other part of the world. He was picked out of his house where his family were too, in the British Army in Northern Ireland, as part of a brutalisation of his community. He was, as a Catholic, denied fair voting rights, housing rights, employment rights, He became radicalized, and then he saw, you know, 14 people shot dead for protesting for those things. And this produces a kind of politics, a liberation kind of politics. It's only possible in those circumstances to stay narrowly nationalist for so long when you've got a working class base and a real liberation cause. And from that point onwards, effectively, Sinn Féin took a popular character, which I think has been embedded more by the growth of anti-austerity politics in the South. They took an anti-austerity line, the crisis hit, their base in working class communities grew, and now they can only deviate so far from that. I think some in the party, no doubt, would want to deviate a lot from it, but they can only deviate so far from that position without losing support.
So, one of my favorite tweets ever about Irish politics was somebody asked why Irish women were still fighting for basic rights to things like an abortion. And the comment was because the British shot James Connolly and not De Valera. And so, I always have to segue that, but I would love for you to talk about the Repeal the Eighth campaign.
Sure. So, one of the reasons I mentioned the relative steps forward during the revolutionary struggle 100 years ago women took was that this was not the case afterwards. So what was built in the south of Ireland, effectively the Free State, it was built on along very Catholic lines, and it produced a way of dealing with problems which I think is important for us to understand. I know there's a Catholic worker tradition in this country which has more liberatory politics, more progressive politics, but certainly the iteration of the Catholic Church in Ireland, which I think was reflective of Rome, they did not want to see social problems dealt with in a social way. They did not want to see poverty as something that was about political and economic basis of society. They wanted to moralize it and individualize it. They did not want to deal with the questions of abortion, the questions of contraception, questions of divorce as phenomena that flowed from within the organic developments of a society. They wanted to see them as moral failings. And this kind of castigating morality was a key theme throughout Irish 20th century history. And it produced the carceral institutions. So where abortion was outlawed in an absolute sense for all but the wealthiest who could travel, we got, in the first instance, very brutal backstreet abortions. But we also got mother and child homes. We got a way of dealing with the social problems that were underlying these things with a carceral state. Where you would deal with things by effectively beating people into the shape you wanted to see society in. This was the same for the Borstal schools, for poor young fellas from the working class areas who, rather than being dealt with by social democratic programs that were fighting against poverty, were cast as feral to be put in institutions and beaten the crap out of by priests in order to reform them as good Catholics. And this happened time and time again. It was the Magdalen laundries, it was the mother and baby homes, it was the Borstal schools, it was the psychiatric institutions. It was a Catholic cure for social ills, which didn't cure much of anything at all. In fact, made us an awful lot worse. But we still have a prohibition, one of the few countries in Western Europe, because of the campaign, relentless campaign of the Catholic Church. I have to concede some bias here. My ma was for many years a pro-choice activist at the height of the zealotry on this issue in 1983, when there was a referendum and into our constitution was introduced the Eighth Amendment, which puts on equal footing in the Irish constitution the fetus and equal right to life, which of course is a part of a long-standing tradition of seeing women as incubators in Irish society and stripping them of their rights to equal citizenship. This was somewhat, this is the reality of situations like this, they don't actually correspond to the world. You can only moralize and beat people up so much. Eventually, you know, things happen which change opinion. And consistently in Ireland, when that referendum passed in 83, from the 90s, we keep getting horrendous cases of crises that raise the question of abortion and abortion rights again and again and again. In 92, a campaign that my mom was involved in, a 14-year-old girl was raped by her uncle, became pregnant, was banned from leaving the country to get an abortion because of the pressure of the church. This became known as the X case. Ultimately, she miscarried, but there was an enormous scandal about this, as there absolutely should have been. But then they put off for years dealing with the, when there was a Supreme Court case that gave her the right to get a procedure with a new interpretation of our constitution. Legislation was not forthcoming. We waited 20 years until another case, there were other ones in between of course, until another case, the case of Savita Halappanavar, who died in 2014 for preventable reasons. She had a non-viable fetus. She was in an Irish hospital. She was told she was in a Catholic country by the nurse. She was prevented from having a basic medical procedure, and she died of septicemia. We then had another big round of protests. They introduced legislation which did nothing because it didn't deal with the constitutional thing. We then had another case, case of migrant Y, which is, in my view, the most horrific case. There was an asylum seeker, a migrant woman, who was raped in her home country and came to Ireland, discovered she was pregnant, and was forbidden from having an abortion. She was forbidden from travelling because she was under the care of the state in the direct provision system that I spoke about earlier on. She was, this is going to sound unreal, but it's true. She had to go through numerous psychiatric tests to see if she was going to be eligible to get an abortion. In the time that, that those psychiatric tests took, the window for her to legally get one under the very narrow window that we allow them passed. She then tried to kill herself. She was institutionalized in a hospital where she went on hunger strike before she was forced to have a cesarean section to give birth to a child. This is the reality of abortion in Ireland in the 21st century. It's why it has to be at the forefront of those of us struggling for liberation. It's why the women's struggle cannot be in any case forgotten or backgrounded or anything else by our left. And so we are fighting for the repeal of the 8th and the introduction of some kind of humane and decent legislation which will allow for, in my view, there shouldn't be any exceptions to full and free choice. But of course, we will see what the politics of that are, but we're fighting very hard to remove that provision from the Constitution which creates those situations.
Two more big questions. First one is, really curious about, because you're much closer than we are, to Labour and Jeremy Corbyn. It's really hard to get a sense of what support he has. You know, The Guardian is one of the few vehicles for someone here in the United States, and they trash him continually. He comes across as being completely inept. So I'd be curious of your assessment of that. And then the second thing is given uneven development and the constriction of the euro, do you really see this thing holding together? I mean, it's hard to imagine, you know, in 10 years, this not having some huge crisis.
10 years would be a long time. It's going to happen before then.
I think
it's a question of time. It's a question of time. I don't see that. I'll start with the second one first. I don't see the Eurozone holding together in the way that it is at the moment. The thing is leveraged to the point where it cannot deal with another crisis. And there will be another crisis. It's just a question of time, whether it's the Italian banks, whether it's the debt in Greece, whether it's a dip in the economic fortunes of Spain, if you know Germany were to slow down, whatever it's going to be, we're right at the tipping point where it cannot take anymore. No more will be given by the more conservative states in terms of bailout arrangements, but no more can be stumped by most of the bailout countries in those terms either in terms of debt. So there is going to be, I would say there's going to be a reckoning in the Eurozone. I think it's a question of when. Jeremy Corbyn is a complex issue. So I've been very close to people in the Corbyn movement since before he won power. I knew a lot of the people in the Labour left going back years. Jeremy Corbyn has an excellent relationship with Ireland and was very supportive in a principled way of the struggles we are facing. My critique of Jeremy Corbyn is this as a figure. I think, first of all, to say I would not give any of the ground that people like Owen Jones are arguing for us to give, which is to say we're going to replace Jeremy Corbyn with somebody who has the same politics as him but is more technically competent. Let's just nail that one straight away. If someone was more technically competent with the same politics as Jeremy Corbyn, they would hate him even more. They would attack him even more. They would try and tear him down even more. So this idea that the problem that the British establishment has with Jeremy Corbyn is that he can't get through a soundbite. It's just like such a bad reading of politics, it's hard to give any credibility to. But he does have problems, very serious ones. Basically what happened with the Labour Party is this: a channel was created through which left-wing politics could be expressed in the party, but a very narrow one. It was only the leadership. The right wing of the party changed the election rules on who could be elected leader and how. They opened it up to a popular vote, thinking they would liquidate the power that the unions and the left of the party had. The actual result was they delivered a socialist to the leadership of the Labour Party. But it's a very difficult thing for them to do, because he is sitting on top of a party, almost all of whom's MPs are relentlessly trying to demolish him. Which the party apparatus is sabotaging him. You know, his first year in office, every time he would go to the Prime Minister's questions, Cameron would have been leaked his questions beforehand by people trying to sabotage him in the Labour Party headquarters. They didn't even want to let him back on the ballot when he was the elected leader, and someone gave a challenge to him. So he has enormous limitations institutionally, and trying to change that would have required a very good strategy, which unfortunately the Labour left didn't have. It was out of power for a lot, not even contesting power since Tony Benn. It lost its way, and it ended up coming into something that's a real problem for the left, which is that its default setting was principled opposition.
I'm sorry?
It was principled opposition. And this is the theme of Jeremy Corbyn's political career, has been principled opposition. He comes from a English socialist tradition which was always more Methodist than Marxist, which saw things in moral terms, didn't see things in terms of questions of power, which left him incapable of channeling anger, and his only response is like an arm around the shoulder. He's the vicar figure on top of all this. That's what he is. And the problem with that is it does not fit the moment. It is not the kind of characteristics that you would need in a populist leader. And that also means when the channel is only the leadership that they have open to them now, and it's so hard to make progress through to reform the party in any other manner, I'm not one of those people who thinks of politics only in terms of personalities, but the personality matters here, because the question is, was Corbyn willing to go in and be a battering ram and at the same time, on the one hand, be a vicar, but be the John the Baptist figure, you know, giving birth to a new movement afterwards? Was he willing to wade through the Labour Party and the right wing of it and reform it and make it a party of the working class? He hasn't been willing to do it, and that's a big problem. The final thing I would say about Corbyn, and it is a very important one for us to remember, why they hate him more than anyone. So why The Guardian? The Guardian puts out some good content. I don't want to hammer it completely. There is a suspicion that I have that it's, you know, MI5 at nice fonts. The Guardian represents a part of the left, most of its writers, which will argue to the left on economic things, but which is rarely, The Guardian is rarely good when you look at foreign policy questions. And this is a historic thing of social democracy. Why is Jeremy Corbyn the most impressive social democratic leader we've ever seen in Europe, or leader of a social democratic party? As much as he's individually not impressive, as much as he's not going to win, as much as this, why is he so important? Because he won't kiss the ring on empire. All the rest of the leaders of the social democratic parties, even the good ones, the same time as Nye Bevan was building the NHS, as you know, a deputy to leader in the Labour Party, at the same time as we were seeing with, you know, Mitterrand the developments of some decent social policies in France and so forth. Any social democratic leader you can think of, the Swedish social democrats being another example of this, they always kiss the ring on empire. And that's the deal that's given to social democracy, is you can improve some things in the economic base, you can have some reforms. Do not mess with imperialism, do not mess with the system as it operates. And Corbyn has whipped his MPs to vote against Syria, he's refused to give ground on Palestine, he's been consistently critical of NATO, he's been consistently saying he wants to abolish the nuclear weapons, and this they just will not tolerate.
So this is a follow-up quick question. So I don't understand why the local MPs don't get voted out. I mean, you have this base that appears to be all for him, and yet I don't understand
the
English system.
Because this is part of the reform process. There's something called mandatory reselection, which Tony Benn and his part of the Labour Party were fighting for in the 80s, which they don't have it. There is no mechanism, there's no primary mechanism for a sitting MP to be voted out by his own party or her own party. And so you have to fight for that. You have to go to a conference, win it. But I was at the Labour Party conference last year with Jacobin, and you know, it was great to see Jeremy Corbyn re-elected. But a lot of these, like, there was no leadership. This is the problem of these people who are not used to contesting for power. Or they had all this mass membership, and tons of them are new to politics, like the kind of Bernie generation over here. But they were not being given leadership in terms of the key battles to reform the party they needed to fight and they needed to win. And that was a failure of the leadership of the party. They didn't win mandatory selection. They'll have to go to next year. Is there really a chance they're going to win it next year when all these things against them and Corbyn doing badly in the polls? This was a bad, like, Jeremy Corbyn could not have been a leader of a left-wing party without making the party left-wing. You had to break apart this Blairite structure. You had to democratize it, reform it, make it a party of the working class again. And they did not. They didn't do it. They didn't fight that battle. They didn't foreground that. It wasn't the first thing they tried to do. And they're paying for it.
One more question.
One final, yeah?
One more. No. Go ahead. I just said.
You mentioned what's going on with Brexit and how it's impacting relationship with the North. Do you think, in your estimation, in the next 2 to 3 years, given the timetable of Brexit, there are going to be serious discussions of unification? Or no?
If you had asked me would there be unification in Ireland within the next 10 years, like before Brexit, I would have said no. But I think there's now a confluence of things coming together. There is the Brexit situation, there is the Scots independence question, which is really interesting for this because, of course, the unionist community in the north originates from Scotland, so their association with Britain, I'm sure it can be extended politically outside that, but on an identitarian basis, it's Scotland. And so Scotland breaking from the Union creates quite different dynamics. I think Brexit is one part of that. I think another part of it is the kind of peace process over time, over a long period of time, softening the divides, not completely, like there's still It's still hard up there. It will still be very hard to win a campaign. And I think Sinn Féin's orientation, one of the reasons it worries me so much, is that there are a few different ways that this thing can go. Sinn Féin right now, the line, I went to one of their conferences on this just before I came here, and the line is, no one has anything to fear from unification. Now, the problem with that line, as well as being apolitical, is
not true.
It's not true. And people are not going to kind of believe that. You can't just, like, just suggesting to people you're going to stitch together these two broken states, unless you have actually something to sell people, particularly in the working class of unionist areas, mostly loyalist people, unless you're saying to people, we have some avenue to improve your life, we're going to try and improve your material circumstances, we're going to fight to make sure you have decent health care, decent jobs, there's investment into your communities. Unless you're making a case that says actually a unified Ireland is going to be a fundamentally new one, which some people in Sinn Féin do want to make, but which their leadership is not, unless you make that argument, we're going to end up with a situation where the opposition is going to be extraordinarily entrenched to it in that part of the community. And it'll be the saddest thing for me. It'll create an inevitable outcome, which will be that it'll be the middle classes of the of unionism, nationalism in the north and in the south that'll come together over the basis of free trade. We want free trade across, like, we'll end up with a unified Ireland, you know, as some sort of like NAFTA proposal, which would be a complete historical farce, to be honest. So I'm really hoping that doesn't happen. But I think actually the most likely course right now, fortunately, is yes, that it will happen in that way. If it happens, I'll vote for it, despite the whatever dreadful scenario is being presented as it. But I would much prefer, and I think the task for those of us on the left, rather than just like looking at that and saying, oh, this would be a terrible campaign and getting despondent, is to say, no, we'll fight for another one. So we'll say, okay, if you won't make the campaign for a fundamentally new society in all parts of the island, saying that unification is not going to be small change, it's going to be a major change, it's going to be an opportunity for us to break both of these states which have so badly served people north and south and create something new, we have to do that. That's the task of the left in Ireland. That's what I'll be returning in a number of days to do.